Well, hello everyone, and welcome to Ash Wednesday service. It's a little different this year since we're kind of at home because of the bad weather. Actually, we could probably be at church, but I know there's going to be bad weather moving in, so I didn't want anybody to stress about it. And it's awfully cold out, so I thought it'd be kind of nice to just be in the comfort of home, and we'll have our Ash Wednesday service virtually this year. But before we begin, there's a few things you're going to need. One, we're going to do communion during service as part of the service tonight. So I stole one from the church. If you want to have crackers and grape juice, you might want to prepare that beforehand. We're also going to impose ashes. Remember, we put the mark of the cross on everybody's forehead. And so you might want to get something to make a cross with on the foreheads of those with you and your family. Lois and I are going to use this charcoal briquette from the grill to make our ashes. Others have suggested maybe you could use the black from the wick of a candle that has been put out. You could use something like that, or you know, you've got a fireplace, you could use some of the ashes from it. Now I can't use mine because it's a gas one, so you have to figure it out. We would normally use the ashes from palm leaves from previous year's Palm Sunday. That's your traditional view, and you mix it with some olive oil, and we use that for the imposing of ashes, but we can't do that this year. So why don't you stop the video, and the service will stop when you stop it, don't worry, and prepare your stuff, and then when you're ready, come back and press play and enjoy the service with the rest of us. I'm sorry we can't be together, but stay in and stay safe, and know that we can look forward to worshiping together on Sunday. We'll see you later.
I'm reading from Psalm 143, verses 8 through 12. Let the morning bring me word of your unfailing love, for I have put my trust in you. Show me the way I should go, for to you I lift up my soul. Rescue me from my enemies, O Lord, for I hide myself in you. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your good spirit lead me on level ground. For your name's sake, O Lord, preserve my life. In your righteousness, bring me out of trouble. In your unfailing love, silence my enemies. Destroy all my foes, for I am your servant. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you this evening for all the blessings that you send our way. Thank you for this privilege that we have of coming together to worship, to open our hearts to you and to your word and to your will for our lives. We do want our lives to exemplify Christ. We want the cross that he bore to be a symbol of what we are as we carry the cross for Jesus' sake. I pray that you would be glorified through our lives and be with those in need of our prayers tonight. Thank you for our church, for our pastor, for this privilege we have of joining together in worship. We ask in Christ's name, amen.
Jonah 3, 4 through 10. On the day Jonah entered the city, he shouted to the crowds, 40 days from now, Nineveh will be destroyed. The people of Nineveh believed God's message, and from the greatest to the least, they declared a fast, and they put on burlap to show their sorrow. When the king of Nineveh heard what Jonah was saying, He stepped down from his throne and he took off his royal robes. He dressed himself in burlap and sat on a heap of ashes. Then the king and his nobles sent out this decree throughout the city. No one, not even the animals from your herds and flocks, may eat or drink anything at all. People and animals alike must wear garments of mourning, and everyone must pray earnestly to God. They must turn from their evil ways and stop all of their violence. Who can tell? Perhaps even yet God will change his mind and hold back his fierce anger from destroying us. When God saw what they had done and how they had put a stop to their evil ways, he changed his mind and he did not carry out the destruction he had threatened.
I fall. Luke 18:9 through 14 reads, "To some who were confident on their righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, 'God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all that I get.' But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, 'God, have mercy on me, a sinner.' I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalted themselves will be humbled, and all those who humble themselves will be exalted."
Well, I hope that you've enjoyed worship. And tonight, since it's an in-home, online-only Ash Wednesday service, things are a little bit more casual, a little bit more laid back. I have a short message for us tonight, but I just want to share with you some thoughts about Ash Wednesday and the Lent season. As you know, today is Ash Wednesday, and it begins a 40-day period of fasting, of self-denial, and of spiritual disciplines. It covers actually over 46 days, but the fasting period is only 40 days worth. And some people look at Lent as a time of sadness and dreariness and maybe a time of depression and darkness. But the reality is we need to see it in the bigger picture. We know the end of the story. We know that Christ rose from the dead. And so we help celebrate that on the six Sundays of Lent. And each of those Sundays, we don't fast. Instead, as we said Sunday, we feast. And sometimes we need to remember that we fast in order to really appreciate and understand the feast that happens in the midst of Lent. This feasting doesn't lessen the importance on the repentance and self-discipline and self-denial that happens in the midst of Lent, but it does place things in the bigger picture. And we realize that the bigger picture is one of victory and of celebration. In Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13, you see the story of Jesus being tempted by Satan after 40 days of fasting in the desert. Jesus spent 40 days fasting, and so Lent is typically traditionally known as the 40 days of our fasting, being prepared for Easter. And I want to encourage you to join in a time of prayer and of fasting, of meditation and reflection and introspection as we prepare during Lent for Easter. But for our purposes tonight, I want to focus for a moment on the temptation aspect that you may have in the midst of Lent. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, the writer in Hebrews tells us, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he remained sinless." Scripture tells us in the story of Jesus being tempted, that after Satan had finished tempting Christ in every way, he left him alone for a more opportune time. Satan will use the same tricks on us as he used on Jesus. He will try to inflate our pride and our ego. He will get us to focus on our own wisdom, on our own strength, and especially on our spiritual strength. This is very insidious temptations. We all want to be viewed as people in positive light, and we want people to think highly of us. But when we get caught up in the pride game and boasting and getting all puffed up, we begin to sometimes think more of ourselves than what we really should. We need to remember that in everything that we are, everything that we have, and all of our abilities, all of our wisdom, and all of our blessings, everything comes from God. Satan will try to divert our focus. He doesn't want us to draw closer to God. He doesn't want us to pray or to fast, and he doesn't want us to meditate on God's word. Satan will tempt you. He will tempt your flesh. He'll sometimes make you desire what it is that you're sacrificing, what you're fasting from. If you're fasting from food, you will suddenly want that food more than what you've ever wanted it before. He'll tempt your eyes if you're suddenly tempted because you're seeing things all the time. You ever notice that when you get a new car, you start seeing that car on the road all the time? It's because now your attention's drawn to it. Same thing happens when we fast from something. All of a sudden, our attention is drawn to that even more. He'll attempt your pride or your ego. Sometimes when you're fasting, you'll be going, look how great I am at fasting. Man, I'm doing this great. And we have to remember to stay humble in the midst of our fasting. The reality is Satan will tempt us using all three of those kind of mechanisms. He did that with Adam and Eve, and he did that with Christ, and so surely he'll do that with us. Adam and Eve showed us that we need to be very careful because we are fallible. We will slip. We will fall. We're not perfect. It is possible for Satan to lure us away and tempt us to sin. But Christ showed us that even though we're fallible, he's able to stand and be faithful and victorious. Even in the midst of temptation, if we find our strength in Christ and we focus on his word, we can resist the temptation. Adam and Eve yielded to temptation, bringing sin and death to all mankind. But Christ resisted temptation, bringing salvation and life for all mankind. Let's use this time of Lent to focus on Christ, to see all that he went through, to experience his love and to identify with him and to draw closer to him. Satan will tempt you because he doesn't want you to draw closer to Jesus. He doesn't want you to pray or to fast and to focus on Jesus. The temptation will be there to pursue the cravings of our stomach or what your eyes see or what your pride and your egos are. But with the power of Christ at work in our lives, we'll be able to withstand the temptation that Satan draws us to. Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, that God is faithful, that he will not let us be tempted beyond what it is that we can handle. But when we are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that we can endure it. So instead of, or in addition to, the fasting of Lent, you might want to add some spiritual exercises or some spiritual disciplines to your life that might help you even more, to grow even stronger and to grow even closer to God. You might choose a Bible study. There are some great Bible studies online. There are great ways in which you can join with folks, even in a Zoom group, if you're not comfortable getting in a small group in person. Or you can join one in person, invite folks to your home and study together. Or come on Wednesday nights and join in on a men's or women's Bible study. Or you may want to participate in an act of kindness. Maybe you want to go and feed folks at the homeless shelter. Or maybe in this time where we have lots of snow, maybe you want to come and shovel your neighbor's driveway. If you want to shovel my driveway, I'll give you my address. Just text me. I'm just kidding. I did that earlier today. Maybe you'd like to add something that you want to do every day. But make it realistic. Make it something that you can actually accomplish. For some of us, it may not be getting up 2 hours early to have extra time of prayer and extra scripture reading. Maybe that's not feasible for you. But maybe there's times in your day that you can carve out to have extra times of reading and extra time of prayer so that you can focus more. Personally, I like to read a gospel, a chapter of the gospel every day. I usually start out in the time of Lent reading, starting in the book of Mark, because I know I can read all of the book of Mark and most of another gospel during the time of Lent. So maybe that's something that you want to start. Or maybe you want to decide, I want to read 4 or 5 Psalms every day during the time of Lent. If you do that, by the way, by the end of Lent, you can read the entire book of Psalms. So there's a couple ideas for you. But maybe there's some different devotionals that you might want to do or some things that you want to add. Maybe you want to just slow down and meditate for a moment and listen to God and say, God, what is it that you're trying to speak to me? I have no idea. If you have no idea what to do during Lent, maybe I can suggest a couple of things. Set aside some time and just quiet yourself. Turn off the TV, turn off music, and just listen to God for a moment and say, God, what is it that you want me to do during Lent? Is there something that I should fast from? Is there a spiritual exercise or a spiritual discipline that I need to add to my day and my normal routine? If nothing comes to mind, like I said, read a chapter of the gospel every day. Read a few psalms every day. Read some scripture and just simply let it set into your life and just ask God to allow that to speak into your life for a moment. So as we enter into the season of Lent, I'm grateful for those who have gone before us, who the saints of the church that have exercised Lent and have grown during Lent and have taught us to exercise Lent to practice Lent and to allow it to grow us stronger in the faith so that we can focus and maybe fully understand even more what Easter is really all about. Well, no matter what you do during Lent this season, my prayer for you is that you will draw closer to God, that you will prepare for Easter and for Good Friday and the Monday, Thursday services that we'll be having during Holy Week, and allow these Lenten practices to just really form you spiritually and grow you spiritually. Well, I've asked Lois if she would join me tonight and as we apply ashes. And so we, like I said earlier, we have a charcoal brick that would be in a grill, and we're gonna use it. Come on in, dear, have a seat. We traditionally in church, like I said earlier in the intro, we would use the ashes from the palm leaves from the year before, and we would mix them with olive oil, and we would put them on the foreheads of each person. And as we apply the ashes, to each person, as we do the downstroke of the cross, we remind ourselves that we have come from dust. And as we go across the crossbar of the cross, we remind ourselves that it is to dust that we will return. And so I will apply ashes to Lois's forehead and her to mine. Remember, it is from dust that you have come, and to dust you will return. I need to grab a few more ashes here. And to dust you will return. And if you would do the same to me.
From dust you have come, and to dust you will return.
Very good. And normally we would leave these on and go out into public and allow folks to see that we have been marked by the cross of Christ, and that our life is no longer ours, but it is His, and that we will allow Him to guide and direct us. And we get our strength from Him, and in the midst of our fasting, in the midst of our daily lives, when we are tempted away from doing what it is that we know that He would rather us do, we would have the cross of Christ in our life and the love of Christ in our hearts, and the voice of Christ through the Holy Spirit, God through the Holy Spirit, into our life as we just live our daily lives. Well, let me pray with us just for a moment, and after our prayer, we'll have another time of another song. How's that? Heavenly Father, we thank You today that we can take this time just to simply rest and quiet our lives. I pray that, Father, that You would speak into our lives right now if we're wondering what it is that we ought to fast, what it is we ought to add, what spiritual discipline we ought to add, or what it is we ought to do for the Lent season, so that we can draw closer to You, so we can spend concentrated time with You, so that we can fully understand the big picture, the picture of Your salvation, Your grace, Your death and resurrection that saves us and gives us forgiveness of sin. Help us to fully understand this more and more each day, Father. And help us in the midst of our life to follow You. We will be tempted. And Father, we know that in the midst of temptation, You promise us that You will provide a way out. You will give us strength. We'll never be tempted by anything we cannot resist. And when we are tempted, Father, You give us a way out. You help us to resist and say no. And Father, if we do give in to temptation, thankfully, there's grace. We can always ask for more forgiveness and more grace in our lives. And I pray that You give us more strength. And Father, as we go into Sundays of Lent, as we have the time of feasting, whatever it is we're fasting from, I pray that You would help us to fully enjoy and understand the feast that happens, so we can understand the big picture, that this is not all about just Your death, but it's more about Your resurrection that we look for in our lives. We love You today, Father. We thank You for Your love and Your grace in our lives. It's in Your Son's name we pray. Amen. Enjoy this song, and we'll come back and have communion in just a moment.
How deep the Father's love for us, how deep.
I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 26, verses 17 through 30. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to prepare the Passover meal for you?" "As you go into the city," he told them, "you will see a certain man. Tell him, 'The teacher says, my time has come, and I will eat the Passover meal with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus told them and prepared the Passover meal there. When it was evening, Jesus sat down at the table with the 12. While they were eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me." Greatly distressed, each one asked in turn, "Am I the one, Lord?" He replied, "One of you who has just eaten from this bowl with me will betray me. For the Son of Man must die, as the scriptures declared long ago. But how terrible it will be for the one who betrays him. It would be far better for that man if he had never been born." Judas, the one who would betray him, also asked, "Rabbi, am I the one?" And Jesus told him, "You have said it." As they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it, for this is my body."
So if you have your communion elements with you, take out your bread, and let's join with the disciples. And tonight, as we take communion, allow us to think for a moment of the sacrifice that Christ made for us in the giving up of his body. And as we enter into Lent, and as we enter into a time of fasting and adding the spiritual disciplines, let us think of the sacrifice that we'll make and how they fail in comparison to his sacrifice. So take and eat.
And then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, "Each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Mark my words, I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Then they sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives.
So take your juice, which symbolizes the blood of Christ, which is shed for the forgiveness of all sin, of all mankind. And as we tonight take this, think of the covenant that we have with Christ because of his blood that was shed on the cross for us. Take and drink all of it. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace, for your sacrifice for us, your body, which was broken for us, your blood that was poured out for the forgiveness of all mankind. We thank you that you love us so much, that you came to earth for us. You lived, you were tempted by Satan, you overcame temptation, you never fell to it. And you lived your ministry of love and of grace, of kindness, of peace. You were not the Messiah that everybody was looking for, but you were the Messiah that we needed more than anything. You were arrested. You were persecuted. You were put on a cross. But it didn't end there. You were buried in a tomb, and you rose on the third day for the forgiveness of all of our sin. And we thank you today, Father, that as we enter into Lent, as we enter into a time of sacrifice, of fasting, we also enter into the celebration that will become ours on Easter Sunday, that we will have each Sunday of the feast from our fast. Help us, Father, to see the big picture, that through your sacrifice, there's great celebration. Through our fasting, we will have great feasting. We thank you tonight, Father. Help us as we are tempted during the midst of Lent to not fast. Help us to withstand that temptation and to fast so that we can become closer to you. Help us to do acts of kindness, to be an exhibit of your love and of your grace to those around us. Help us to add spiritual disciplines to our life, a time of reading and prayer and study, so that, Father, we will become closer and closer to you. Help us, as we said in our last series, to be marked by your presence. Help us to enter into this sacred invitation that you've given to us to live a life that you have for us, the best life ever. We love you tonight. We thank you for your love and grace. It's in your Son's name that we pray, Father. Amen. Well, I hope that you've enjoyed our Ash Wednesday service. I know it's been a little bit different. I love meeting together, and I love the symbolism, and I love the atmosphere of our Ash Wednesday services normally. But tonight, as we've done it at home, I guess we have even our cat involved, we get to have kind of a quieter time, a time of more intimacy with just our family. But don't let it end here. Allow this just to be the beginning. Know that this Sunday, as we gather together, we'll be having a missionary couple come and speak with us. It's Gary and Elizabeth Ekman. Elizabeth was a teen in our church many years ago and is now getting ready to enter into the mission field. And we get to have the great opportunity of being able to join them and partner with them in their ministry. So as we prepare for Sunday, pray what God would have you to give in our special offering toward them so that we can support them financially as they go wherever it is that God leads them to be missionaries for his kingdom's sake. I hope you stay in and stay safe, and when you're out and about, stay warm, and if you need anything, make sure that you call us. May God bless you and keep you. We love you. Good night.